butter, jelly, dried beans, and rice. Seeking daily devotional cards for Lent. You can pick up your daily devotional cards at either sanctuary entrance. These start on Ash Wednesday, February 14th at 10:30 a.m. Ann Doris United Women in Faith Day Group meeting. Stay for a Valentine lunch provided and served by the Night Group of UFW in Heritage Hall. Bible study will be Wednesday, February 15th at 6 p.m. in Heritage Hall. And February 22nd, 6 p.m. will be the Ash Wednesday service in the sanctuary. And again, as always, please fill out your attendance pen at the end of the pews if we know you were with us in worship today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
It is a joy to be in worship with you this morning, and it is a joy that I am actually able to speak to you this morning. As of Thursday, we weren't so sure I was going to have a voice for today, but I'm sorry you have to listen to me anyway. A note about the devotional cards, if you remember last year, we had these daily devotional cards through Lent that went with our theme. Again, we have those this year. Our theme is seeking, and if you got our newsletter, you could read more about our theme. The seeking theme will be in our worship services. It will be in our Wednesday night Bible study. There are children's lessons this year, and so I hope that you will pick up a set of the daily devotional cards and use them however you feel led. There is no right or wrong way to use the devotional cards. You can read all of them in one day. You can read them one day at a time. You can pick out your favorites to reflect on through the season of Lent. However you want to engage with these cards is correct. And so I hope that you will use them. Most importantly, I hope you know that whether this is your first time or you have been attending for years, whether you are strong in your faith or you still have some questions, no matter your age, your tax bracket, your ability, or the color of your skin, no matter who you love or who loves you, you are welcome here. And I invite you now to join me in our call to worship. Come, walk in the way that leads to life.
It is better to be reconciled with another than to be proven right.
Come, choose to live a genuine life.
Life is too short.
Come, walk in the way Christ invites us to travel.
We give thanks for Christ's way and for the freedom to follow.
I invite you now to stand as you are able as we sing together hymn number 358, Dear Lord and Father of Man.
Thank you.
Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
extend as you are able for the reading of the scripture. You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, "You shall not murder," and "Whoever murders shall be liable to judgment." But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, "You fool," you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on the way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, "You shall not commit adultery." But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. It was also said, "Whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce." But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, "You shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord." But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. It's easy to forget that this is the season in which we are continuing to celebrate the birth of Christ, the entry of the light of God into the world. The Christmas decorations have long been replaced with Valentine's Day and St. Patrick's Day. The Christmas lights replaced with patio furniture sets. The Reese's peanut butter cups are now shaped like eggs instead of trees. Epiphany definitely does not get the same shelf space at Target as Christmas and Easter. It also doesn't necessarily get the easiest scriptures in the lectionary. The baby Jesus is one that is much easier to understand. And who doesn't prefer babies over adults? And yet, the season of Epiphany and the Sermon on the Mount provides us with such an important reminder. During Epiphany, we claim once again that we have a living God, incarnate among us, not some far-off God who must be humored with occasional acts of obedience. We proclaim that the Word became flesh and lived among us. The Word embedded in real, everyday life, in outward actions and inward attitudes. We proclaim a God present in the flesh and bones of our lives, not some keeper of checklists. God's inbreaking presence in Jesus Christ reorders the relationships of this world and reorients the internal landscapes of our lives. Last week, we were reminded that Jesus did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. And with this continuation of the Sermon on the Mount, we continue to hear the reminder of how relational the law truly is. The law demonstrates that everything is created to be in right relationship with everything else. And Jesus comes not to make us inflexible or morally superior, but to show us how to live in mutual, loving relationship. Jesus brings new life to this law, to the Mosaic law. He sees the ways in which it is being used by the elite to maintain power and status, and uses the traditional teachings on murder and adultery and prayer as essential grounds for building his case for righteousness. Using familiar, perhaps even too familiar, teachings, Jesus intensifies and radicalizes them for his listeners, extending these teachings into almost every area of life. In this way, Jesus does not abolish but fulfills the law. No longer do the teachings on murder and adultery apply strictly to the acts of murder and adultery. Instead, they become doorways into the examination of many internal dynamics, as well as external behaviors of one's life. Anger, derision, slander, false generosity, litigiousness, arrogance, lust, temptation, alienation, divorce, and religious speech. Perhaps one of the most radical aspects of Jesus' extension of the law here is his internalization of it. So that not only behaviors, but attitudes and emotions also fall within its scope. As United Methodists, we believe in three kinds of grace: prevenient, justifying, and sanctifying. Sanctifying grace is the ongoing work of the Holy Spirit that changes us so that our lives are increasingly conformed to the mind of Christ. Sanctifying grace is what gives us the ability to reach Christian perfection in this life. The articles of faith to which we United Methodists hold say of sanctification: entire sanctification is a state of perfect love, righteousness, and true holiness, which every regenerate believer may obtain by being delivered from the power of sin, by loving God with all the heart, soul, mind, and strength, and by loving one's neighbor as oneself. Through faith in Jesus Christ, this gracious gift may be received in this life both gradually and instantaneously, and should be sought earnestly by every child of God. At its core, Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount invites us to critically and gracefully examine ourselves and our relationship to those around us so that our outward actions and our inward thoughts match. Jesus connects the dots for his listeners from outward acts to internal orientation, from murder to anger, from adultery to lust. It is one thing to behave rightly. It is another thing entirely for one's heart to be oriented towards love. Just as it is easier to make a sacrifice at the temple than it is to do justice, like we find in Micah 6, so it is easier to keep the commandment against murder than it is to avoid anger in one's heart. Jesus offers a more radical ethic, a reign of God ethic, one already hinted at in the list of the Beatitudes preceding this discourse. the poor in spirit, those who mourn, the pure in heart. All of these are blessed, not because they are exemplars of the law, but because of their inward orientation of the heart. The righteousness of this newly inaugurated kingdom of God is more than following rules. It requires and empowers a life surrendered to God and to neighbor. In addition to our belief in sanctifying grace, John Wesley also triumphed social holiness. He said, "There is no religion that is not social, no holiness that is not social." Reverend Susan Henry Crowe with the General Board of Church and Society said, "Wesley goes on to say that without social holiness, we cannot exist. It is because of God's love for us and Christ's love that we reach out into the world to walk with others and to accompany them on their journeys. Because social holiness is unique to us, it means that we must be in this together. We live our lives together, and we live our lives with all of God's creation. We walk with one another. We walk with those who are poor, those who are vulnerable, those who live on the margins of life. It is a gift that God has given us, and we claim as Methodists who are committed to social holiness, that we would be with one another in this journey as we live our lives together." And at the core of Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount, it demands us to leave behind the behaviors that separate us from God and separate us from one another. He urges us to allow the kingdom of God to saturate our entire lives and invites us into deep and meaningful and accountable relationship with one another. And this is good news. The God born in a manger enters the messiness of life in all of its dimensions, seeking to heal and to save. This God offers a life deep and wide where light shines into every nook and cranny. Not a puny flat life reduced to avoiding the big sins. Jesus gives the disciples a new way of life, not rejecting the tradition, but building upon it. It is a way of life that demands more and promises more. It is life abundant. Thanks. At this time, I invite our ushers forward for this morning's offering. Let us pray. Oh God, pour your spirit upon these, our gifts. May they be used to further your kingdom on earth so that all might know your radical, extraordinary, unending love. In Jesus' name we pray. as we come to our time of prayer this morning, Ms. Rosie Clark is going to be offering our pastoral prayer, and then will lead us in the Lord's Prayer this morning. We also give thanks for Luke and Andrew, who just served as our ushers. A few concerns we want to lift up this morning. First is that you can find our full prayer list on the back of the bulletin. We also want to keep Randy Boyer in our prayers. He fell last week and broke his leg. He is at the VA here in Clarksville for his rehab and recovery. We also want to lift up Cora Lee Gibbs, who is having a procedure this week in Springfield. We also want to remember the victims of the earthquake in Turkey and Syria, all of the damage done and the lives lost and those injured. Are there other joys and concerns this morning? Robert?
My niece.
Robert's niece had her second baby girl this morning, and so we give thanks for her and for Robert's new great niece. Yeah.
Mary Knightsky had her 91st birthday this week, and Robert also had a birthday.
We celebrate, we have about 1,000 February birthdays. And so we celebrate each and every one of them and give thanks for another year of life. Are there any others? Seeing none, let us go to God in prayer. Turn a little bit, because everyone wants to see your beautiful faces. So for the God and Family Award, I present to Andrew for learning the Ten Commandments, learning how God works with and through families, and learning to keep God as a part of your family. I present you with the God and Family Thank you. I present you with the God of Me medal. Let us congratulate our scouts. I invite you now to stand as you're able for our closing hymn, The Charge I Have to Keep, hymn number 413. Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer.